So hello, my name is Pantelis Antoniou. I work for Konsulko Group. We're a small consulting company. We are Linux experts, we think. And we're lately starting to do stuff with Zephyr. This is a side project for me, so it's my 20% project, so be kind. So I think everyone has heard what's going on with IoT. A couple of years ago, it exploded. Everyone started talking about it. This is the standard definition, which sounds exactly like the stuff that most of us have been doing for decades before. So exactly what changed? Well, what changed is that now there's a big market and stuff have gotten cheap enough so that it's now open for other people besides geeks or people working for big companies and having big budgets. I'm not going to talk in this presentation about any kind of IoT protocol because there are so many, and frankly, I have no idea which one is going to be the winner. There's so many, they're competing, and I have no clue who's going to be the winner. But I know that we need to figure out a way to make Linux and Zephyr or whatever small real-time operating system work together. So IoT on Linux is not a new thing, has been around for many decades. We've been doing that stuff before it had a name, but we used to do stuff with custom protocols, standard servers, no clouds, but everything is on Linux already. So we have all join MQTT, Weave, XMPP, everything is on Linux. But we cannot use it on a big class of IoT devices because it's just so big. Yeah, so that's correct. So, well, if you have a general purpose Linux distribution, it's going to be a lot. So, and people like to use it. So if you're going to use Node.js or all that stuff, it's not going to be something small. It's going to be huge. So if we're honest with each other, who would use anything else than Linux if you can use it on an IoT device? We would all use Linux because it's what we know. We know we have all the software support we need. It's not small. That's the problem. We cannot fit it on those small SoCs that are targeted for the IoT space. So we cannot use it for small devices. And it has other features as well, like it is quite secure. We have a very, very well scrutinized IP stack. We have security experts going over it. And I'm pretty sure that if you had a choice between a homegrown IP stack or a Linux IP stack, you would use the Linux IP stack. You would use all the servers, all the daemons that you have on Linux. You wouldn't want to write your own SSH server. You wouldn't want to write your own SSL library. You would want to use what's ever out there. Now, if we take a look at the I/O capabilities, there was a presentation a little bit earlier by Matt Ranoste about the I/O subsystem, which pretty much covers every kind of analog to any kind of sensor that you could possibly hook on an IoT device. But you don't have that on a real small device. And the big thing again is price. You can get an IoT SoC to be as cheap as $1. You cannot get a Linux system with enough RAM and enough peripherals even close to that range. So we have to run IoT stuff on a half a dollar part. And yeah, we could get by with $1. The target price is for stuff that it's like dust. So let's say you have a field that you want to to put a seed there, instead of having to do expensive sensors. What if you had really small, expendable, disposable IoT devices that you could use in the seed and just spread them around, and then you could read them and see whether you need to water the field or put a fertilizer there. But you cannot do that if the device is too expensive. You need something that's you don't even think about if it gets lost or whatever. Again, take a look at light bulbs. So you know there are connected light bulbs out there, but they are expensive. And okay, so you can buy a $15 or $50 light bulb, but it's a choice. You have to think that I want to buy this cool gizmo that costs $50 for its light bulb I won't use. But what if the price of the light bulb was just $1 more than a normal light bulb? Then it would be, you wouldn't have to think about it. You would just buy the more fancy one without thinking about it. And so since you can run Linux on those kinds of devices, you need another OS operating system for that. So I set out and said, okay, I need a real-time operating system for these small kinds of small devices, and we have a lot of options right now. So these are the most relevant ones in that space. Yes, it is, and it's the mostly used one, actually. Yep. For really small devices, you don't put anything there. So you have FreeRTOS, Embed OS, Natex, Magenta, or Little Kernel from Google. This is a new thing; they just came out with it. You have none, and then you have Zephyr. So I went through each and every one and started listing all its plus and minuses. So FreeRTOS, I don't know how many of you work with FreeRTOS or know about it. Anyone? Yeah. So it's pretty popular. It has a dual license, so it's GPL version 2, but with a Lincoln exception, or you can buy a commercial license. But its API is really sparse. It doesn't have a lot of functionality. It's just a scheduler and maybe some memory management. Everything else is an add-on. There's not really a community around it. It's mostly the company that makes it. It has a preemptive thread model. The networking is an add-on, as I said, so there's no high-level frameworks. It's a really bare-bones operating system for people that are moving on from bare metal, which might not be what we need. We might need something more powerful. So Embed OS, how many of you have heard about it, used it? So when I started looking at it, Embed 5 wasn't out yet, so there wasn't even an RTOS option for it. It was just an event-based API based on C++ with a really nice build system. It has an Apache 2 license. It pretty much has everything you need for IoT, but it has it tries to push you into using the cloud that ARM provides. So it's really constricting for an open source guy like me. So there are a few problems with it. Since it's based on C++, it also uses the most memory. So I think the minimal application for it is something like 80K, which might not be enough, too big, but for really small parts that are like 16K or 32K, it's too big for it. I know it's really popular, but it wasn't good enough. So Natex, how many of you have used Natex? Okay, thank you, Matt. It has a BST license. So that means that you can use it wherever you want and you don't have to release anything. It's pretty convenient. It really strives to be like Linux, but lighter. So it has a pretty large community, but if you take a look at the commit logs, 80% of the commits is coming from Mr. Gregory Nutt himself. So it's pretty much in 1 month show. So it's POSIX compatible, so it's easy to port stuff from Linux. The problem is that it is like Linux. It's only the kernel. You might get stuff for it, but there's nothing else IoT related. So you just get an IP stack, nothing else. And it's quite, after embed OS, it's quite large. So it has more functionality, but it gets to be like 50 or 60K just for the minimal application. So Magenta is part of Fuchsia. Don't ask me what Fuchsia is because I couldn't figure it out. It has an MIT license, and it's really little kernel. How many of you have heard of little kernel? Yeah, you're on Android, so it's used on bootloaders. I don't know where else you use it.
I've had to read little kernel source code.
It works. It's really popular. I think it's really popular with Qualcomm. Yeah. I have no idea, but it's popular.
Qualcomm has other OSs based on little kernel for the myriad of the CPU cores running on their processors.
Yeah, I know. I heard NVIDIA does it too, but I don't know. It's just a bare bones real-time operating system. It works. It's small. Maybe that's all they need. It has a little bit of scaling issues. It doesn't have too many priority numbers. The primitives are pretty primitive. I tried to figure out whether there was a networking stack in the Google supplied sources. I couldn't figure it out. So there must be a networking stack, but I couldn't find it. And then this is a Google project. So there's a problem with the infant mortality. You never know when Google will pull the plug and then you'll be left with nothing, because all of this is Google engineers, and when they're gone, the project is gone. So you can see what happens with Project Ara, for instance. None. So yep.
Sony's done this about 50 times.
It works, and it's the fastest one that you can get, but you have to be pretty hardcore. I'm not that hardcore anymore.
You need to be metal.
Yep. So now we're up to Zephyr. The last license is standard Apache 2 license. It has a network stack. Well, actually, it has two network stacks. It has one for IPv4 and one for IPv6. It's got a nice real-time operating system API with a nano and a micro option, which is pretty useful, because if you don't do much and you don't need the micro option, you can get by with just the nano option, and the nano option is excellent for fitting into very small parts. So with the nano option, you can get it down to 8K of flash, which is pretty decent for a full-featured operating system. It's really familiar, if you're familiar with Linux, because it has a Linux kconfig build system. And that's what I used, so I had some experience with it. So it's a nice fit for what we want to do. So when we try to do IoT on Zephyr, we see that there are quite enough of libraries already integrated, and more are coming. So we have libraries for CoAP, Bluetooth Low Energy. We have Contiki and TinyDTLS. TinyDTLS is pretty important. It can be really small. We can port whatever else we need, and we know that IoT vendors will provide IoT libraries for it eventually. And now the question is, this presentation is about Linux and Zephyr, so where do both of them fit in? So there are some problems when trying to do IoT stuff on Zephyr on, and on every real-time operating system that's really small and not very widespread like Linux. Security. So let's say you have an IoT node and you put a Wi-Fi chip there and you use it for your home application. So that means you will have to store your Wi-Fi password there. You might need to store credentials or whatever. If this device is so small that you might have to put it outside the house or whatever, that means someone can steal it. And if he can read the memory, he can get your Wi-Fi keys and whatever else is there. So you need to put enough stuff there so that you can communicate on the network, but you shouldn't put too much because then you have a security problem just because of the nature of the devices to be disposable. Then you have convenience. So when you have just a couple of devices, it's easy to, well, it's not easy, but you can conceivably update software, perform software update for each and everyone. But when you have, let's say, 50 or 60 devices on your house or in the example for in the field when you might have a few hundreds or 1,000 devices, how do you update the software? You might need to update it. So it's going to be pretty painful even if you have an automated method like software update or S3 or whatever. Then the next problem is future proofing. So you might have enough space to put a single IoT protocol in there, but who knows what's going to happen in 10 years? Would you expect to change your light bulbs if in 5 years from now a new IoT protocol is out and you had to support it? Probably not. And you would be really pissed if you had to throw away light bulbs that cost like $60 or $50. So the company might go out of business, and this happened. Which company was it that had an IoT-enabled light bulb and then went out of business, and then the cloud stopped working, and then the light bulb stopped working? It's not very fun, but you have to think about them. So you might need to make sure that your investment in whatever you buy survives for 10 years. And then you have the warring tribes problem. When you don't have enough space in the flash, you don't have enough space to support any kind of protocol. So let's say you have an iPhone and your wife has an Android phone. Would be nice if you could only control half of the lights in your house. It would be easier if you're trying for a divorce, but not really. So,
or using just light switches.
Yeah, but that's a low-tech solution. We're all geeks here.
I work from Philips Connected Lighting, and my wife loves that option. Just a mechanical switch in the wall.
Well, if you can make your wife do whatever you want, you're a happy man, but... So I think the solution would be to have a Linux gateway. So you could run whatever IoT protocol you want on the Linux device and then have slave Zephyr IoT devices. You have no problem supporting any IoT protocol at the same time on a Linux device, because things have gotten really cheap right now. You can buy a chip for, I don't know, $15, an RPi for $20. I don't know how low it got. So it's got enough RAM for any kind of protocol. It's got network interfaces. You can easily update it, and it's secure. It's ideal, but how do you talk to the sensor on the IoT device? do you have, will you have software running on the IoT device? Well, maybe there is a solution. We have to look at what an IoT SoC contains and what an IoC sensor looks like if we were to address this problem. So what is an IoT device? It's just a cheap SoC, typically running an ARM M-core or a PIC or x86. Intel came out with a few on AVR. Anyway, the idea is it's a very small, low-end part, not enough CPU. It has a few GPIOs, PWM, serial, some standard interfaces, and a way to get on the network, whether it's at Wi-Fi, 6LoWPAN, or could be something custom. So it all depends on what you use. What else is there? It's some analog glue interface. So you might, if you have a sensor that reads humidity, you might need just an I2C bus so that you can plug the sensor in and then read the data. It's very price sensitive because if you have something too expensive, no one will buy it, especially if there are parts in China, even if the software sucks. If you're 10 times more expensive than the other guy, no one cares whether you run Linux or whatever else. The price is really important. You don't have a large enough battery. You just have a very small power budget, and less is more. So that means you should get by with the smallest system that you can find, and you should really design for it. So let's go back to Linux. So Linux has the full I/O capabilities that an IoT device requires. You can read the humidity sensor. You do have GPIO devices, device support on Linux. You do have PWMs. You have everything that an IoT device uses. But your sensors are not connected to your Linux box. They're somewhere else. So instead of running a full IoT protocol on the sensor, why not just get rid of everything and make all the Zephyr devices simply Linux peripherals? That means you get your software running on Linux, your sensors are really small, they're cheap because you don't need anything else besides a networking stack. The software load on the devices is not different. So let's say you have sensors that are based on a similar SoC, you don't really need software on the sensor because everything is running on Linux and it will just access the devices directly without having a different software load for each different sensor type. And you can abstract all of that by using Linux kernel interfaces. So you can present a remote GPIO as a local GPIO on the Linux device. We can present the remote humidity sensor as a local humidity sensor. So everything works as if the sensors were connected on Linux, and the applications on Linux work exactly as if the sensors were there. There's no software difference at all. You just need a way to transport the peripheral commands from the IoT device to Linux. Security problems. You have much less of an attack surface there because all the sensors are completely dumb. They don't contain anything that's important. You don't have to use the same communication protocol that you use for IoT. You can engineer something that's really small. It's secure enough for your needs for transporting samples, but there's no big importance to the samples. So you don't have to have great security. You just have to have good enough security for that. So you don't have much software there. And if you can get by pre-programming the keys for the communication on its device without using the network interface, that means it's more secure. So I don't know how many of you were in a presentation that some Disney guys had with, they made a lead-based communication network. They were cheap LEDs, and the LEDs can also work as a receiver. So you can get by creating a very, very cheap communication medium using standard LEDs. You can program them with an smartphone, and you can put the pre-programmed key in the device without using the network interface. So when you go to provision the device, you just flash it with smartphone, you set the keys for the communication keys with the gateway, and then you're done. You don't have to use anything else. You just pre-program the keys like you were, there was a serial port and you program it by hand. It's much more secure than having to manage keys. And the device then is disposable. You don't care about it. Even if you lose it, there's nothing important there. So now let's go to some implementation details. So there are two ways to go about it. So you can go bare metal, which means you just you directly have access to the small SoCs resources like GPIO registers, PWM registers, and you essentially have enough software in the IoT device to boot, present itself on the network, and then you directly poke registers and have access to the I2C buses, SPI buses, from the Linux gateway. That means you don't have any software at all on the device. You can even put it in ROM, and it's time you use it from the gateway. Performance is not very good, though, because instead of transporting samples or the data, you might need to perform the register accesses over the network. That's slower, and you might need more power because the radio would be turned on for a larger amount of time. Well, the second way would be to have class drivers. So you have a thin class layer where you present a GPIO class driver for the remote peripheral, a sensor class driver for each sensor you might connect there. So that means you might have a different software load on each IoT device, which is, it's not very desirable, but you get better performance and less power. Well, I don't have a demo yet. This is my 20% project. I do my work on a BeagleBone and a little Galileo. I have something that provides remote GPIOs, but no I2C or SPI to come. I use device tree overlays to load and unload the sensors and the GPIOs, so that's where it's useful. I do that over Bluetooth Low Energy. I use pre-configured keys with DTLS, and I hope I'll have a demo on the next embedded Linux conference in Portland. So I think that's it. So any questions? Yeah, because that's not a Google project. It's Greg Gates' project.
So, are you considering reusing Graybus for your purposes?
I could. There's nothing that precludes me, but I can get by with device tree overlays as well. It's an implementation detail. If you can present remote peripherals, either way would work. So you can support both if you want. Yeah.
How practical do you think is
would say, to some extent, your approach on thinking of IoT devices, or at least the sensor part of it, as disposable. In my experience, there's nothing as permanent as a temporary or even disposable solution. And especially, have you thought about the security impact of something that you consider disposable not being disposable?
Okay, this is getting philosophical. I don't know, the target is something that you don't care about if you lose it. So if there's any other impact, I don't know, environmental or something, I haven't thought about it. But I don't know, maybe there's biodegradable electronics in a few years, maybe.
So they are definitely temporary.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's the same. As far as the upper layers are concerned, it's the Linux device that's the IoT sensor node. There's nothing, the upper layers don't know anything about it. So it's the same thing as having a failure of an IoT device, but it has more interfaces.
If you're connecting directly to each of the nodes,
yep. Then you can give one phase and there's no problem. Yeah, you can have two gateways. There's nothing that precludes you of having a failover. But I haven't thought about that yet, so, yeah.
What's the split you have right now in kernel and user space?
Most of the stuff is in kernel. The user space just sees the user space interface, as if the peripheral was local. So
you're going from, like, a Bluetooth networking?
Yeah, you have a helper that goes out of the kernel, communicates, and then fits it back. The idea is so that you don't have any difference between a local peripheral, because if you do have a gateway, you might be tempted in putting a few sensors there as well, so you don't want to use it to lose it. Yep.
Are you thinking about some kind of discovery mechanism?
No, the whole idea is that this is fixed. If the IoT node gets up and communicates and authenticates, because you have to know the pre-configured key, then it will show up. There's no authentication mechanism. That's the point. So that you don't want it to be complicated. I don't want to reinvent other protocols. I just want something for transporting peripheral data out, in and out. Anyone else?
The networking component driver side, how tight is it?
It's not tight at all. You have a well-defined kernel interface, something like WPA supplicant or something, which uses a Netlink socket. And then you can use whatever you want to aggregate stuff. So there's no tying to any kind of networking technology. If you can push packets in and out, it should work. Yep.
Did you attend the IWD presentation from Marcel Holtman this morning?
Nope, because I was in another.
So he basically wants to replace WPA supplicant with IWD, and the thinking is the kernel has key rings and crypto, so move all that out of user space into the kernel, and that sounds like that might be a good fit for you.
Yep.
It's still an Intel open sourcing hell, so the code is not public yet, but soon.
Well, I didn't know about that. I'll take a look, but it does make sense, because even for the user space approach, I would use a crypto dev interface so that I could offload a few stuff out of user space if I can, because you're gonna be running on an embedded part and you don't have too much power. Yep.
What did you think that the benefits were to present it as a actual device on the gateway instead of just accessing it through a library that has network?
Because I want a very hard interface to be exactly the same as a local resource on Linux. So the application developer doesn't know anything about all that stuff. he's just working on as a Linux application accessing Linux peripherals. So you don't need another interface. It's the interface is what the kernel provides.
So the basis were to make an infrastructure for future development.
Yeah. So if you have an application that works on Linux, it should work without any changes. Just point it to the remote peripherals and get it work, and that's it. Well, there is Zephyr running on the IoT node because I need the networking stack.
You don't need it. Do you? I mean, the way you partition the system now, there's no logic left in the endpoint.
No, no, there is logic on the endpoint, but it doesn't have to do anything with collecting data that are IoT related.
Fixing the kind of the interface to user, right? So you can trickle down the whole thing and fix everything.
It doesn't need anything, but it does need a networking stack because you need to. If you can supply the implementation, because I will only do the Zephyr implementation, I won't do anything else because we do open source stuff. If you can, there's going to be.
Normally, has a dispatcher and the stack somewhere has a dispatcher.
Yeah. Yeah, but I don't want to tie it to Bluetooth. Bluetooth is just a single.
Every stack has its dispatcher.
Yeah, yeah. If you can get it to work on anything else.
We won't need a general purpose.
No. But it's easier if you just use Zephyr because we will provide an implementation that works. And then it's easier if you just use Zephyr. It's going to be based on Nano Zephyr, which is really small, just 8K. So it's not that much of an overhead for what you want to do, because, okay, you might want to do more stuff. I don't want to be tied exactly to that model. Yeah?
Do you have a sense of how big your overlay blob is right now?
You mean how many devices?
No, this actual size. I was just wondering, like, could you have that blob?
Yeah, because it's overlays are typically like 200 bytes, 300 bytes. Yeah, it could work, but you increase the storage requirements and you need to program it on the device. Yeah.
And the idea is to never update the nodes?
Yeah. In theory, you could just have it programmed from the factory with ROM without any flash whatsoever. There are some other ideas about using things like eBPF fragments. So if you need to do some kind of processing, if then, PLC stuff. In theory, you could do an eBPF program on the host, JIT it into the target, compile it, and then transmit it and have it execute. But that's a little bit further off. But it should work as long as you're willing to develop it. But the idea is that you don't have any kind of software that you don't need on the node. It's just standard stuff that will always work. Yeah. Whatever, you just need a way to transport packets.
Yeah,
using a BLE, but no, I don't need it. Anything else? Okay, that's the case. Thank you for suffering me.